Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. This is amazing grace.
You may be seated.
Good morning, Daybreak family, here and online with us today. We're so happy you're here with us. My name is Keith Swank, and I'm pleased to be here today, too. We want to tell you about a few things going on in the church. First off, today's Communion Sunday. Next Sunday, the 13th, we'll have a baptismal service. And after church next Sunday, we're going to have Discover Daybreak. So it's a light lunch we provide it, and you'll be able to see what Daybreak's all about. June 20th is Father's Day. We have a special gift for every dad on that day. Plus, we'll have a root beer float for everybody. So, and on June the 11th, this Friday coming up, there is a bridal shower for Nina Swank. And if you are interested in attending, please see Shirley. Also, if somebody's good with a camera, she'd like to have you show up there, too, to take some pictures. And men, you're not invited. So instead of that, we're going to go out and shoot some guns or something cool like that, okay? We have a little connection card in here. And whether you're the first time here, second time, or Daybreak is your church, we appreciate you to fill this out, to fill it out with prayer requests and praises and suggestions possibly for Pastor Tim. For instance, I suggest that maybe he shouldn't do the whole show himself. So here I am today, right? So this is my audition. So if you like what I do, tell him about it. If not, that's fine. Get me fired. I'd be good with that too. There are many ways to worship. We worship by singing. We worship by listening to God's word and obeying it. And we worship with our tithes and offerings. And would the ushers please come forward? So there's three ways you can do this. You can give right here at church. You can go online and give the Daybreak. Or you can mail a check to Daybreak. And make sure you use the P.O. box, because if you use the street address, it won't come here. Okay?
How do you know
that?
So use
the P.O. box. And I know that because I had a check loss for 3 weeks because I mailed it to the street address. Okay? So we really appreciate you all being here. And let's say a prayer. Dear God, we love you so much, and we thank you for this opportunity to join together and worship you. We thank you for the blessings you have bestowed upon us. Please give us the wisdom to use our tithes and offerings in ways that will bring glory to you. We know our mission is to help others find and follow Jesus, and our tithes and offerings will help us accomplish this. We ask for blessings for everyone here with us today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you, Keith. Do you guys think you did a good job? What do you think about having drums up here this morning? Woo!
this world. I will lay at your feet, surrender every anxious thought for perfect peace, your perfect peace. All the loved ones I hold dear, all my hopes and dreams and all my fears, I will choose to trust your name in everything, in everything. I will look up, for there is none above you. I will bow down to tell you that I need you, Jesus, Lord of all. Jesus, Lord of all.
I will take you at your word. Jesus, you have taken hold of me. All my life is in your hands. You are my strength. You are my strength.
I will look up, for there is above you. I will bow down to tell you that I need you, Jesus, Lord of all. Jesus, Lord of all. I will look back and see that you are faithful. I'll look ahead, believing you are able, Jesus, Lord of all. Jesus, Lord of all. Prince of Peace, perfect healer, all my life, all my cares on you. King of Peace, mighty Savior, all my life, all my cares on you. Prince of Peace, perfect healer, all my life, all my cares on you. King of Peace, mighty Savior, all my life, all my cares. I will look up, for there is none above you. I will bow down and tell you that I need you, Jesus, Lord of all. Jesus, Lord of all.
Let's sing that one more time.
I will look up, for there is none above you. I will bow down to tell you that I need you.
Thank you for being Lord of lords, Lord of all in our lives, O God. We just give you the praise and glory for it this morning, Jesus. And Lord, we just love telling our story to others.
I love to tell the story of unseen things above, of Jesus and his glory, of Jesus and his love. I love to tell the story because I know 'tis true. It satisfies my longings as nothing else can do. I love to tell the story. 'Twill be my theme and glory to tell the old, old story of Jesus. Tell the story, more wonderful it seems than all the golden fancies of all our golden dreams. I love to tell the story. It did so much for me, and that is just
shame is undone.
Thank you that we can worship you this morning, oh God, in this place, together, inviting the Holy Spirit to join us. Hallelujah, Lord. We thank you so much. We thank you so much. You may be seated this morning as we continue to worship the Lord. It may not be in song, but we're continuing to worship the Lord. We're continuing to worship the Lord this morning with our communion, with our communion. The communion took place just before Jesus was arrested, just before Jesus was betrayed and crucified. Jesus was with his disciples, enjoying the Passover feast, when Jesus gave them the new covenant. When Jesus said there is something new that's going to take place, and what is going to signify that something new is this wine and this bread. We can find this story told to us by Paul in 1 Corinthians chapter 11. And it's very clear what Jesus is trying to tell his disciples as we read this. But But the thing that's important for us to know is that here at Daybreak, communion is open to everyone. Everyone is welcome to join us and participate with us in communion. The one caveat is this, is that you are a follower of Jesus. That somewhere in your life, you have accepted Christ as your Savior. No matter how long ago that may have been. If you claim Christ as your Savior, if you've given your heart and turned it over to Him, then you are welcome and encouraged to take communion with us this morning. On the night when He was betrayed, the Lord Jesus took some bread and He gave thanks to God for it. And then He broke it into pieces and said, "This is my body, which is given to you, and do this in remembrance of me." So as we participate together as a church, let's go ahead and open up that cap and let's go ahead and get the piece of bread that represents Christ's body, given to us, broken for us, so that we can call upon Him as our Savior. Heavenly Father, we lift up this piece of bread, this cracker, that represents your body, given to us, so that whosoever call upon your name shall be saved. Bless this bread this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's take it. Paul continues, "In the same way, he took the cup of wine after supper. This cup is the new covenant between God and His people, an agreement confirmed with my blood," Jesus said. "Do this in remembrance of me as often as you drink it." We know what happened to Jesus once He was arrested. We know that what the things He endured for us after He was arrested. And that blood that was shed for us is that cleansing power for us, to cleanse us as white as snow. And so as we take this blood, as we take this cup representing the blood of Christ, it's more than juice. It's an opportunity for us to do this in remembrance of what He has done for us. Lord, we thank You. We thank You. We honor You. We glorify You. We thank You that You are in our lives and You made it as simple as it could be. But Lord, it was because You poured out Your blood for us that makes us white as snow. Bless this cup now today. Continue to be with us, guide us, and use us for Your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's take the cup. Amen. You know, we were having such a beautiful week this week with weather. What happened? Now, I enjoy cool weather, and I heard someone say recently that if it gets any warmer, they're going to leave. There's a reason why we enjoy the Northwest, isn't there? We enjoy it for many, many reasons. And one of them is that this is the moderate temperature, the moderate weather. You know, as soon as it starts hitting like 75 in my house, I'm looking for the air conditioner. Where's the fan? Yesterday was a little disappointing, but you know what? I think we'll survive. Speaking of yesterday, it was the first Saturday of the month, and maybe many of you know that I serve as chaplain for the Seattle Harley Owners Group. And If I can get my computer to wake up. And so what they ask me to do is they ask me to do biker blessings once a year. Well, because of the circumstances that we're in, I've kind of spread that out. I didn't depend on doing it on one day, but normally that's the procedure. One day a year, we'll have a big celebration. We'll have a big biker blessing. We'll invite everyone. The dealership will get involved, and it's a great event. But this year was a little unique, and I've actually been doing biker blessings all year long. But yesterday, our chapter got together for the first time, physically. We've been doing this by Zoom. I'm not a big fan of Zoom. I'm just going to be honest with you. I'm not a big fan. But we're kind of forced to do it this year. And so we actually got a chance to meet together. And I just want to let you know that the word of the day for yesterday has nothing to do with today's sermon. But it has everything to do with our daily lives. And I just pray to God, whenever I have an opportunity to give the word of the day to my Harley chapter, it's an opportunity for me and the Holy Spirit to speak into their lives. So the word of the day yesterday for my Harley chapter was miracle. Miracle. Because I challenged him. I said, I bet you that you have experienced a miracle in your life. Maybe when you weren't hit by that truck. Or maybe you know of someone else that experienced a miracle. Or maybe you need a miracle in your life because of health. So I just wanted an opportunity to speak into their lives. And I pray that the Holy Spirit will use those words of the day during our monthly meeting to touch their hearts, to plant seeds. So I had an opportunity to do biker blessings yesterday, and I didn't think I was going to get too many because I've been doing them all year long. But we did 10 biker blessings yesterday. And I just have an opportunity again to plant a seed of faith into their lives and allowing God to use it any way he sees fit. Well, this morning we're starting a brand new 4-week series. It's called Something New. I'm not looking behind me right now because I'm not sure what the slide looks like. Oh! Good job, Kurt. Kurt and I don't always agree on vehicle brands. So it's kind of a fun rivalry, you know. But thank you. That's a great truck. I wish I had something new like that. But that's not the something new we're going to be talking about for the next 4 weeks. But that's a great slide. Good job, Kurt. The church itself. You recall, as Jesus had the Last Supper, as Jesus introduced his disciples to the new covenant, for which we just celebrated with communion, very shortly after that, Jesus gets arrested. And Peter, denies him 3 times. And so, at that time, at the point of Christ's crucifixion, the disciples are kind of going their own way. They're kind of doing their own thing until that great Easter morning when they all get a chance to meet their risen Savior. But after Jesus departed, there really still wasn't a church. There wasn't really a church as of yet. So the church kind of began in an isolation, so to speak, or in separation, apart from others, because they were in fear of persecution and even maybe death. But then something new happened. And the church was never the same again. You know, growing up, I don't know if you remember this, but I remember when we landed on the moon. I watched it live from my neighbor's house. All the kids were standing around, sitting around the, could have been a black and white TV. I don't remember. 1969?
It was black and white.
Thank you, Juanita. And, you know, I remember how amazing it was that we were able to accomplish what I thought was a miracle. Because anytime else, we don't ever read or Flash Gordon, or we read books from Jules Verne. We had no idea that we had the capability or the technology to do something new, to go to the moon. That's some good news. The bad news is that we've been in this pandemic, haven't we? And that's been something new for all of us. It has affected our lives and our friendships, and even our families have been put on hold. And our churches, we've been experiencing something new, and to be honest with you, it hasn't been good. We're just starting to come back together now. We're just starting to open up. And I believe God wants to take us, wants us to go back and not do the same old, same old. I think he's got something new for us. Something new here for us at Daybreak. And guess what? We've already seen some things, haven't we? We've seen some new things happening here at Daybreak. And I believe God is preparing us, this church, Daybreak, to do something new. To do something differently, in different ways than we've ever done before. One of the things we as a church need to do is we need to ask God, what is it you would have us to do? Do you have something new for us? And do you want, and what do you want us to do? And how do you want us to do it? And maybe God allows us to experience grief and pain in order to prepare us for something new. You know, when we got a chance to hang out with my Harley chapter yesterday, it was the first time that we either actually physically got together in one place, and it felt so good. I believe preparation is essential for fulfilling the call of God. He prepares us when we spend time alone with him, and when we are able to listen and focus on what he's trying to teach us. It is absolutely paramount in my life that I spend that time alone with him, that I spend my time reading. And you know, throughout the Bible, this isn't something new that I'm sharing with you this morning. Could be because throughout the Bible, we read story after story about how people spent long periods of time alone as God prepared them for what he has for them, preparing them for something new in their life. Jesus was 30 before he started his ministry. Moses had fled from Egypt and was in the desert for 40 years before God called him to tell Pharaoh, "Let my people go." It took David running away from Saul to become the king God had called him to be. There's a great book out there. This book is called The Tale of Three Kings. It's a short read, but it's a fantastic read. I strongly encourage you, download that book, get the book, A Tale of Three Kings. It's a great story about David and Saul. It took Elisha walking with Elijah to learn what it meant to be a prophet and have the heart for God and to trust him. And for the church, where was that beginning? That church was in the upper room, wasn't it? Was it last week? The week before last? We talked about Pentecost Sunday, didn't we? We talked about what it meant and where the word Pentecost came from. 50 days. 50 days following the resurrection of Jesus Christ. 50. Pentecost, 50. They celebrated it by being in the upper room. You know, this morning we're going to take a deeper dive into something new that was about to happen to the disciples and to the followers of Jesus. The upper room was a place where they could spend time praying, spend time hearing from God, spend time being empowered by the Holy Spirit to do his work and to do his will. For us,
What is God calling us to do? Is there something new for all of us? My answer for you is probably yes. Probably yes. It's all been new for Sharon and I when we have enjoyed every single day. You guys have embraced us and loved us, and we just love you guys. And it's just been a wonderful experience for us, but it was still something new for us. Do you know, I believe that there are people who call Daybreak their home church, but have not yet come back. They haven't come back because of COVID, and they are reluctant to come back. This pandemic has changed a lot of us, and sadly, maybe some of that change is permanent. I hope not, because I believe He is calling this church to do greater things than they have ever seen before. Here's your first fill in the blank this morning. If you got your programs, open them up, pull out that insert. That's for you to take home. Proper attitude is essential to accomplish God's purpose. Proper attitude. We just can't do business as usual. We just can't do business as usual. And if we take an honest look at the past, how well did it work for us? We must allow Him to show us something new, to show us what it is He has for us to do, and to show us how to minister to the people around us. To show us how to minister to the people around us. What will your priorities be? What is God calling us to do? What are the things that we will value? And how will we communicate the gospel of Jesus Christ that God has entrusted us with? You know, in the next few weeks, we're going to take a look at the church. We're going to take a look at the church and how it was formed, how it formed community, and how it valued Jesus, and how it engaged in its mission. I believe God wants to empower us to do something new. He wants us to do great things in His name. And this morning, we're going to take a look at how the church was formed. And the story about the church being formed we find in the book of Acts. So this morning we're going to be all over Acts a little bit. So this morning our first verses will be in Acts 1, chapter 1, verses 4 and 5. In Acts 1, 4 and 5 says this: "And once He was eating with them, He commanded them, 'Do not leave Jerusalem until the Father sends you the gift He promised, as I told you before.'" This is Jesus speaking to His disciples. Jesus continues in verse 5 by saying, "John baptized with water, but in just a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit." And Jesus said, "Do not leave Jerusalem." In some of the translations, it says, uses the word wait. Wait. Who here likes to wait? Anyone want to volunteer? Anyway, when we want an answer to something, we want it now, don't we? I don't know about you, but growing up, I would ask my mom, "Hey, what's this word mean?" And what would she say? "Go look it up. Go look it up." So how do I look up things now? "Hey, Google." Right? We want that instant gratification. We don't want to wait. You know, sometimes I'll get a little hungry after church, and we'll be on our way home, and I'll look at McDonald's, right? And then I'll see the long line. I'll just keep going. I just don't want to wait, okay? Because it's hard to wait for the conclusion or the outcome. We want to know now, don't we? How is this going to actually work, Pastor Tim? What's it going to look like? What's it going to feel like? I want to know now. God wants us to learn. He does. And sometimes that means wait. Don't want to wait. Sometimes it means wait. God wants us to learn to trust Him. He wants us to learn to hear His small voice. And He wants us to learn moderation and self-control. You know, He allowed the disciples to be on their own so He could bring them together with something new and something powerful. Jesus told His disciples just prior to His ascension to come together and wait. Who has been in the military? What's the old slogan? Hurry up and wait. Wait. But Jesus is telling His disciples to wait for something new. To wait for the power to preach the gospel throughout the world. His disciples would become more than individual followers. They would become the body of Christ. They would become the family of God. And when we come together as the body of Christ, like they did in the upper room, that's when we can have an impact for this world. Yes, Daybreak can have an impact for this world. I believe it. We already have an impact. If you take a look at the board as you go out, we're supporting missionaries all over the world and at home as well. This morning we're going to be covering the three E's. It's a philosophy, if you prefer. You know, and maybe we can use these three E's to kind of bring us back to basics as we're starting to open up in this pandemic, as we're starting to come together, and as church becomes our new routine, maybe we can use these three E's. I believe if we do, God will use us to do something new, something greater than ever before. Because we must learn to rely on Him. We must learn to know Him. Because we must learn to be close to Him. We are going to encounter God, first E. We are going to encounter God, be engaged and united with each other, and empowered by the Holy Spirit. When the church was first formed, they encountered the reality of God. They encountered the reality of God. Acts chapter 1, verses the first half of verse 14 says, they all met together and were constantly united in prayer. Constantly united in prayer. This church loves to pray. We spend Thursday mornings, 10 o'clock, everyone is welcome to come and spend time in prayer. Every Sunday morning at 9 o'clock, while the band is rehearsing, you can come for a time of prayer. We believe prayer is vital. They knew Jesus personally, didn't they, the disciples? They ate with Him, they prayed with Him, and they walked with Him. But now, something new. Jesus was no longer with them. How do they relate to Him when He's no longer physically there? They had to experience something new. They had to move from sight to faith. They needed to have an experience that was new and powerful in a different way than they've ever experienced Jesus before. How did they begin to do that? Prayer. Prayer. First was with prayer. They learned how to pray. They learned how to talk to Him in prayer, and then they listened to Him. And because of prayer, we all have direct access to God. You see, Jesus is our advocate. It's a legal term. Because there's an accuser out there. And we need an advocate. He's an advocate on our behalf to the Father. They learned that they could encounter Him through prayer, and so can you. They also learned, number two, to worship. To worship. They honored Him. They gave Him the glory. They adored Him, and they lifted Him up. And when they and when we come together in prayer and in worship, they become an essential part of encountering God, that big E, encountering God. I believe as the disciples met in the upper room, they prayed and worshiped like they had never, ever done before. They learned to give God the glory. They learned to articulate to God what was on their hearts. They learned how to give thanks for all that he had done, and so should we. And so should we, if we hope to have an encounter with God. The number three thing, the third was obedience. They go from prayer to worship. It leads to obedience. Out of prayer and worship, our hearts want to obey. The ultimate result of prayer and worship is obedience. If we submit ourselves to Jesus, what are we telling him? What are we telling him if we submit voluntarily to Jesus? We are telling him that we love him and that we honor him and that we trust him. But if we don't obey him, what are we telling him then if we do not obey him? We've missed the whole point of our relationship with him. How can we say we love Jesus and then turn around and not do what he's called us to do? You may have had some wonderful times of prayer. Maybe some wonderful times of prayer and worship. But it's all meaningless if you don't take the third step. If you do not obey him. If you refuse to follow God's word. The prophet Samuel said, to obey is better than sacrifice. What does that mean, to obey is better than sacrifice? We can faithfully come to church every Sunday. We can even faithfully give our tithes every Sunday. But if that's the extent of our relationship with Jesus, it is better to obey than sacrifice. Obey is a 24/7, 365 process if you love him. If you pray and worship to him, your next step is obey. God is calling each one of us to obedience. And when they encountered the reality of God, and when they were ready to obey, they changed the world. The next thing they did was the second E. They engaged in healthy relationships with one another. They engaged in healthy relationships with one another. That's one of the things I enjoy about Just Coffee, Just Guys on Thursday morning. And we're going to expand that a little bit because I think it's unfair for the guys that still work that they can't come on Thursday morning. So there's got to be something new. But I enjoy that Thursday morning because it's an opportunity for the guys just to come hang out and talk about stuff, Ford trucks, and get an opportunity to hear God's word, to fellowship together. Be engaged in healthy relationships with one another. Acts 2:1 says, and on the day of Pentecost, all the believers were meeting together in one place, and they were in close relationship with each other. They have already spent a lot of time together. And not only did they need to spend time with God, but they needed to spend time together, to be knit together. God knows we need both. He created us that way. He created us with the ability to have a horizontal and a vertical relationship. That's how he created us. Because it's absolutely essential to have both. And that's why the greatest commandment says what? To love God and to love others. Because God created us with the ability to have both the vertical and the horizontal relationships. We have to be willing to say, we have to be willing to believe and act on our love for God and our love for others. Guess what? even when they may not agree with us. Even when they may not agree with us. And that can be so hard. The news is filled with these ugly protests, filled with destruction of property that I don't think I have ever experienced in my lifetime. And it's quite apparent that there are some people who are not okay with their fellow man, especially if you happen to wear a certain type of uniform. They are definitely not okay with you. Now, I don't know if you guys noticed or not, but doing Law Enforcement Memorial Week, which I think is like the first or second week in May, I hung a law enforcement flag on our rail out front. It was stolen. It was stolen. Why? It's because there are people that don't happen to agree with us that we should love others. But even if they are disagreeing with us, that doesn't change the command, does it? Love God and love others. We need healing. We need the truth to be revealed, and we need to see and experience God's forgiveness and repentance, no matter how hard it is. I believe as a church and as your pastor, we may need to step up in new ways. We can make all the excuses for our attitudes and behaviors. We can make strong arguments to justify our anger. If we don't change the way we feel towards other people, if we don't change the way we act towards other people, or the way that we should love each other, then what we preach and proclaim becomes meaningless. Your anger and your attitudes become your gods, small g. This is very hard for me to preach, to share with you, but I'm asking you to do an honest self-evaluation. Does my anger and my attitude outweigh the greatest commandment? The new thing that happened, that began to form this awareness, that happened in the upper room, that Jesus loves everyone, for God so loved the world. This upper room experience started out as a Jewish movement. It was easy peasy for them just to tell other Jews, the Messiah has come. But as the book of Acts points out, something new happened, didn't it? The gospel spread to all aspects of society, Jew and Gentile alike, and it wasn't easy. You can read it for yourself. They had struggles with it. But because they did, they reached every corner of the world. And it all started because they began to build relationships that were strong and powerful, and because they valued each other. How did they do that? They loved more fully. They learned to love God and each other in a deeper way. They learned to reach out to each other, and they learned to engage one another. And ultimately, out of their love for God and their love for each other, they began to love the world. They were able to accomplish the Great Commission. And because they loved God and because they loved each other, they loved the ones God called them to. Lord, I love you, and I love others. Just don't call me to those people. Okay? I'm fine with everything else. Just don't call me there. There's a great story in the Bible about that, isn't there? It's called Jonah. He did not like the people of Nineveh. And he made it crystal clear to God, I ain't going. Well, God had other plans, and he wasn't giving up on Jonah. God has other plans. He's not giving up on you, and he's not giving up on me. And so because of that, because God called them, and because they responded to his call, they cared compassionately. And I'm sure it was a learning curve. It's a learning curve for each of us. They cared compassionately. I believe compassion calls us to action. Compassion calls us to action. One of the greatest compassion ministries, in my opinion, is Convoy of Hope. This church supports Convoy of Hope. Convoy of Hope is an international organization based out of Springfield, Missouri. But they have leaders in every single state. Convoy of Hope was developed by a man named Hal Donaldson. And he's got a great story. And I encourage you to look him up and hear his story about compassion. And because of his compassion, because of the compassion that God laid upon his heart, he now feeds millions of children around the world. He helps farmers in third world countries to show them how to grow their crops more efficiently. He feeds children. I said that already. And he helps women, especially single moms in third world countries, learn and develop a skill so that they can sell their product and support their family. It's a great, fantastic organization based on compassion, because compassion calls us to action. Compassion is more than a simple nodding in agreement. It's more than a feel-good moment. True compassion compels us to move and compels us to act. Years ago, Sharon and I heard this heartbreaking story about gypsies in Romania. They are a people that the people of Romania want nothing to do with. They are isolated. They are excommunicated. They want nothing to do with them. And in their poverty and in their grief, they've got children raising children. The parents are gone. And they live in these muddy fields, and their homes are nothing more than mud blocks that they live in. But someone out of compassion, a missionary, two gypsies, recognized that there was an ability and a possibility to build an orphanage for the gypsy orphans. Sharon and I said, we can't be left out. We cannot be left out. We feel compassion for these people. How can we help? So Sharon and I spent 2 weeks in Romania building an orphanage. No, we didn't build the whole thing in 2 weeks. We did little odds and ends. We were a part of that building process. And now hundreds of orphaned gypsies in Romania have a roof over their head and a meal, because we were compelled to move because of compassion. In this moment in time, how will you choose to act towards your fellow man? How will you choose to act towards those who are different from you? Do you choose your rights and privileges, or do you choose to love your fellow man? Ouch. Oh, I love my rights. I love being an American. But sometimes I have to make a decision. Do I love others more than I love my rights and privileges? How do they know the love of Jesus is in me if we choose ourselves over them? How will they know that love? Is this something new for you guys? Is this a new challenge? Do we ask ourselves, do we care with deep compassion? Or do we allow our Facebook emojis to speak for ourselves? So easy to hit that smiley face or that love heart. And I do it, and I'll probably continue to do it. But is that the extent of our care and deep compassion? It's one thing to say it. It's another to do it. The disciples in the upper room cared deeply and compassionately for those who didn't know that Jesus was the Messiah. And because of that, they were bonded in unity. They agreed with what their mission was. When God calls us together to be on mission, He unifies us. He unifies Daybreak when we are on mission together to help people find and follow Jesus. And from that unity, we share our love for Christ. We share our love for one another. And then out of that unity comes a unified mission, vision, and purpose. And when we are in unity, and when we are moving together, doing what God has called us to do, we are powerful. It's not because we are doing the right thing, it is because we are doing the right thing together. And when that happens, here's your last E. We are empowered for the life of significance. Empowered for a life of significance. He has a great desire for us. He has a great mission for us, and He empowers us to accomplish that mission together. Acts 2, in the first 10 verses, tells us the story. Acts chapter 2, starting with verse 1, says, on the day of Pentecost, all the believers were meeting together in one place, then suddenly there was a sound from heaven, like the roaring of a mighty windstorm, and it filled the house where they were sitting. Then, what looked like flames or tongues of fire appeared to settle on each one of them. And everyone present was filled with the Holy Spirit and began speaking in other languages as the Holy Spirit gave them this ability. And at that time, there were devout Jews from every nation in Jerusalem. And when they heard the loud noise, everyone came running, and they were bewildered to hear their own languages being spoken by the believers. They were completely amazed. How can this be? They exclaimed. These people are all from Galilee, and yet we hear them speaking in our own native language. The power to engage the Great Commission didn't come from themselves. It didn't come from the calendar of events or having all the boxes checked on our to-do list. And here's when it hits home for me. It didn't come from team meetings that discussed all the possibilities. There's Kurt. He knows my team meetings. I love team meetings. It's a great opportunity to communicate, but that's not where the power comes from. They were empowered to do something new when the Spirit came upon them. They were empowered to proclaim and testify of God's great love. They were empowered with purpose. Your testimony, your story, empowered by the Holy Spirit, guess what? Has a great impact. You may not realize that impact when you tell your story, but empowered by the Holy Spirit, it does. It starts to break up that hard ground in that person's life that maybe needs a miracle, that needs something new in their life, and they don't know where to turn, but you've got a story. You've had a miracle in your life. When something new happens, God has a reason. And that reason is always the same thing. It is always to proclaim Him, to proclaim to Him those who don't know Him. And that's what the disciples did. After being empowered, they proclaimed who God is and they declared His power. These uneducated fishermen, speaking in the language that they had never learned, declared who God is and proclaimed Jesus as the Messiah. They told their Jesus story. And the people listened. And because of that, 3,000 people came to accept Christ that day as their Messiah. And when you are empowered by the Holy Spirit, and when you tell your Jesus story, when you tell how Jesus transformed your life, and how Jesus has blessed your life, and how He gave you a future and a hope, and how He changed your destiny. Tell your Jesus story. Tell it with boldness. With boldness. before the service starts, I'd love to get prayed by Jane and Barb down here. And you'll never guess what Barb prayed for me this morning, that I would be bold in my sermon this morning. Thank you, Barb. So I'm encouraging you, when you tell your Jesus story, and when you know that it's empowered by the power of God, because you know it is, because your life is an example of it, tell it with boldness. You are not afraid. I am telling you, I'm not asking you not to be afraid. I'm telling you already, you are not afraid. You are not ashamed of what Jesus did for you. Be bold as you tell your Jesus story. And when the followers were no longer, when the followers of Jesus were no longer quarantined in the upper room, they had encountered the reality of God. They had engaged in healthy relationships, and they were empowered for a life of significance. And they began to do exactly what Jesus told them to do: go and make disciples. That's what I want to challenge you this morning. Spend dedicated time in prayer and in God's word every single day. Become empowered by the Holy Spirit, and then go. Go and tell your Jesus story. Look for that opportunity to do that. Sharon and I enjoy walking around Eatonville on Tuesdays and Thursdays. We just walk around. And that's our prayer. Lord, give us an opportunity to tell our Jesus story to someone on the street here and get a chance to meet them. Allow the Holy Spirit to empower and embolden you. We look around in our world and we see people, don't we? We see people who are fearful. We see people who are hurting and confused. We honestly can't look around today and say, everything's great. It's just fine. It's not. It's a stinking mess. The only hope we have, the only hope our country has, the only hope this world has is Jesus. We've got the message, and we have the access to the power to proclaim it. We need to be the church in new ways. In ways that we at Daybreak have never seen before. We need to be the church that is ready for God to do something new and something powerful. And what the world needs help with is clarity. To be clear, not wishy-washy, not watered down. It needs to be clear. It needs to have clarity. And we need to be clear with the message of Jesus. That message that we deliver with our words and with our actions have to match up. We need to walk the talk. Peter delivered a message of clarity. And this is what Peter said in simplicity: people who call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Saved from their anger. Saved from their hurts. Saved from their bitterness. And saved for a new life in Christ. Our neighborhood, our town, our nation needs a new hope and a new life, and that life is in Christ. They need us to be the people God has called us to be. Here's the question I want us to wrestle with over the next few weeks. What is God preparing? What is God preparing for us as He is planning something new for Daybreak? What is God preparing you? What is God preparing for me as He's planning something new for Daybreak? And what will He use us to do? I believe He may be building a new community within us like we at Daybreak have never seen before or ever experienced or could even ever imagine. I believe that we will become a more caring, a more compassionate, and more generous than we have ever been before. We will respond with a willingness of service like we've never experienced that before. No longer sitting back and letting someone else do it. Can I testify that I have never experienced this in my life, in all of the teams that I've been a part of in ministry. Every Sunday morning at 10:05, our team comes together for prayer. And it's amazing how many people call Daybreak their home and who have taken the next step into that call of service and want to be a part of it. And I just look around the room as we begin prayer, and it just brings me to tears. And I encourage you this morning, on your connection card, take that next best step. Volunteer. Become a part of our team. We will respond to God's calling. We will respond to God's calling without fear or doubt. And how will we accomplish God's mission in a new and greater way? By the three E's. By encountering God on a daily basis, by engaging in healthy Christ-like relationships, by being empowered by the Holy Spirit, and then by aligning our vision with His. And what's His vision? That none shall perish. None. And by aligning our priorities with Him, what are His priorities? To love God and love others. And then by aligning our mission with His, and what's His mission? To go and make disciples. To help people find and follow Jesus. You see, it's all about making new disciples. Didn't I talk about that last week? We're not trying to steal from other churches to fill these chairs. We're looking for people who are hungry for something new, something more powerful in their lives, something that will give them hope. Let's give that to them. Let's share our Jesus story with them. It's about being used by God in new ways so that the world around us can be reached for Christ. Amen? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we look around and we see a hurting and broken world around us. As we open our lives up to you and we encounter you. As we unite together to accomplish your mission of going and making disciples. Lord, use each and every one of us this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Would you please stand with me? If you have your Bibles, you can open up to Numbers chapter 6. I didn't bookmark it. Numbers chapter 6. And I want to leave you with my favorite benediction this morning. May the Lord bless you. May the Lord protect you. And may the Lord smile on you and be gracious to you. And may the Lord show you His favor and give you His peace. In Jesus' name. Amen. Have a great Sunday. Go and share your story.